today we are more connected than ever. In almost every pocket in this room is held a rectangular device that if you have our Wi-Fi password here at church, you can connect with anyone in the world pretty much. You and I are a screen swipe away from connecting potentially to one third of the world's population. 2.32 billion smartphone users in the world. This revolution that we are a part of seems to have no downside, right? More connected, we have more information at our fingertips than at any time in the history of humanity. Who doesn't want to be able to instantly send a picture to a relative in Taiwan? Who doesn't want to be able to video chat with loved ones who do not live near us? To be human is to connect to one another, and we're more connected than ever, right? It seems too good to be true. But studies are showing that true close friendships seem to be on the decline. Isn't that strange? Connected more than ever, connected more than any other generation, but true connection being harder and harder. I think this is maybe going to be our generation's hardest struggle, is true connection. True connection to our friends, true connection to our family, true connection to our spouse, to our children. We may have hundreds of friends on Facebook, but not many true friends that we can call when we're in a crisis. Do you feel that irony in your own life? You sense that disconnect of being so connected and yet not. How can we connect? What does it take? As we hear Jacob's story, I think we'll find some answers today. Let us pray. Gracious God, help us see your truth through Jesus Christ, who is the truth. Amen.
Amen.
Jacob, at this point in his story, comes to the end of himself. Jacob is finally returning home. You all know the story of Jacob. Do you know why he had to leave home in the first place? It was because his brother wanted to kill him. His brother Esau said, "Soon I'm going to be burying my father, and then once I do that, it'll be time. I will kill my twin brother, my twin brother." And why was Esau so angry? Do you remember why? Esau, as being a twin, was barely a little, just slightly older than his brother Jacob. And for some reason, their mother liked Jacob a little bit more, and so she had this plan. Hey, let's trick your dad. Can't see very well. We'll pretend that you're your brother. He will give the older brother's blessing to you. And then you'll get what you want. And he kind of said, I'm not sure, but the mom pressed him. And he does this. He tricks the father to give the first blessing to him. Esau finds out and is furious. And that's why, well, if you're dead, then I get my blessing back, right? So this is the story today we have is Jacob. He's been away. He's been in exile. And now he's coming back. Now, if you remember, This is the family of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, these three generations. This is the family who's been promised by God the promised land to be a blessing to the whole world, all of this. And so Jacob knows, I can't just be in exile. I have to go back. I have to go back to the land. I have to go back where God wants me to be. And Jacob, as we see throughout his life, tries to do everything that he can to control every single situation possible. He's a master at controlling his situation. He controlled his brother. He controlled his father by tricking him and manipulating him. He goes away and goes back to his father's homeland, and he connects with his uncle, his mother's brother, Laban. And Laban is also a manipulator, someone who controls. And if you remember that story, he falls in love with the second daughter, Rachel, not with Leah. And Laban says, oh, you want her? Fine, then work for me 7 years. And he says, okay. He works for him 7 years. He goes, okay, you ready to marry my daughter? Yeah, I'm ready. And he tricks him and has him marry. He must have had a lot of wine that night. He married the wrong daughter. And he wakes up and he says, what are you doing? I wanted Rachel. You gave me Leah. And he said, well, it's our custom that the older daughter gets married first. You can have her as well, but work for me another 7 years. Fine. A week passes, and he does this. So Jacob is a manipulator. His mother taught him how to manipulate, it seems, as well. And then he goes into this other relationship with Laban, his father-in-law, who is this master manipulator and controller. And he gets rich. He gets blessed. Because, again, he manipulates the situation. He says, Laban, let me take care of the sheep that are spotted and streaked. They will all be mine. And you get the ones that aren't. And so he has this very strange breeding program with the sheep. So that the strong sheep are spotted. He puts like these branches that have sort of paint as you rip their bark off. And so the strong ones he lets breed where they're, and it's really weird. It's really weird. But you can read that on your own. My whole point is that Jacob is in control. And Jacob has received blessing. And Jacob has received wealth. And Jacob is doing really well for himself, it seems. But finally he says, Laban, I gotta go. I gotta go back home. I know God has called me and blessed me, and I got the blessing from my father. I tricked him. And I know God is going to be doing so much through this family. I need to go back. Problem is Esau, right? He's confronting the brother who wants him. Has everything that he could ever want, but he's been manipulating and controlling every part of this story. But Jacob knows he's not right. Jacob knows to go back to the blessing, he has to confront Esau. He tries to return to mend a broken relationship with his brother, a relationship broken because he tried to control it so much. Even as this is happening, even as the story is unfolding, he's still trying to control his brother. He takes everything that he has, all the money he has, and he's sending it ahead of himself. He says, okay, you, servant number one, you go first, and you tell Esau, all of, you know, this is, my master's coming, and just, you know, kiss up to him, brown nose, do all you can, suck up to him so that he will accept. And then servant number two, you go to servant number three, he's sending everyone ahead of himself, kind of soften up Esau before he meets him. And as we see in the passage today, he even sends his family ahead of him across this ford of the Jabbok. He's by himself. Probably the reason why we who are so connected today are not so connected is this idea of control. Social media can seem like we're connected, but we're not, because we control it. When on social media, I get to post every single victory in my life to make everyone else jealous, maybe, if I have a really bad heart, but I can post every single victory. This is why I did. Well, I just got back from vacation. This is why I did. I wanted to post some vacation photos, but I'm like, but other people are not on vacation. I have some people on Facebook who are retired, and I just, whenever I see them, man, I'm jealous. They're just, you know, fishing all the time and all this stuff. But so I was like, I'm not going to post anything. But on social media, we get to post everything. We get to curate, right, who I am presented to you. I can make sure my family is happy and no tears, right? We never fight and everything's wonderful and glorious. Every time I have a defeat or a setback, I will not post that either. I can Jacob my relationships on Facebook. I can control it so that only blessings are acknowledged. I can Jacob even those who disagree with me. I can just unfollow them or unfriend them or hide their posts, right? I am in control. Let's bring Jacob and Esau back into our day a bit, contextualize them a bit. Jacob basically is coming back, wants to reconnect, wants his brother to accept his friend request. After he has hacked into his account, tricked his father to give him the password to the bank account of his will so that he stole all of them. This is what sort of is happening. He's a pretty bad guy. And how can Jacob undo this? How can Jacob control how his brother will respond? As we saw, he sends wave after wave of wealth before him to try to appease his brother. Venmo payment after Venmo payment, trying to make sure that when he finally meets his brother won't cut his head off. So Jacob sends his two wives and their many children, 11 children, it says at the time, across the ford of the Jabbok, and he is alone. Utterly and completely alone. There's no internet at the ford of Jabbok, not even Verizon. There's no bar there, no bars in Verizon coverage. At the ford of Jabbok, no Wi-Fi, nothing but himself. Nothing but himself and his creator. Have you ever been on the other side of the Jabbok? Completely and utterly alone. Every resource available to you, spent. Nothing left. Nowhere to turn. A night where you wrestle. I was reading the other day about a blogger who was blogging furiously. I mean, that was his job, and he was making a lot of money doing it. He was tweeting and just being part of the flow of information, this super fast-paced flow of information that is the internet. And he was just breaking down. His health was getting nowhere. And so he went on the spiritual retreat. And when he went on the spiritual retreat had you turn in your cell phone. And it was also pretty much a silent retreat. You couldn't talk to anyone. Except for every once in a while you'd have 30 minutes or an hour with your spiritual advisor to talk about how things are going. He said 2 or 3 days into it, he was alone in the woods and it felt like he had a nervous breakdown. He just started bawling. He stepped out of the stream of all this information and connectedness and had to really deal with some deep-seated issues in his own life that would never have been revealed if he hadn't ripped everything apart away from him. And he went to his spiritual advisor and said, "I just couldn't stop crying the other day. I was crying for me. I was crying. I don't know what's wrong with me. I think I might be nervous for me now." And the spiritual advisor, kind of with a smirk on his face, said, "That's fine. It'll get easier. It'll get easier." Being by yourself, coming to the end of yourself, all of your resources, to wrestle with God. You want to connect, and wrestling is, of course, a connection. You're connecting with someone, but it's a violent connection. I never wrestled. Did anyone wrestle in this room? My dad wrestled, and he was telling us during the vacation that he has the cauliflower ear. Because back then, they didn't wear ear protection. And when you're wrestling, you're violently getting your head slammed against mats and rubbed and everything. And things can happen between cartilage and blood vessels and stuff like that that are just really, really nasty. But wrestling is a violent, violent thing. And Jacob is wrestling with, it says a man, we're not really sure. His name changes to Israel, so it means wrestles with God. Did you know that? Israel, the name Israel. Jacob's name turns to Israel, you know, the tribes of Israel, because he has 12 male children that are the heads of the tribes of Israel. But that word Israel that comes all the way to us means wrestles with God. I don't know who he wrestles with. Whoever he's wrestling with, whether it's God, whether it's this man, the man who will not name, is it an angel? Is he wrestling with himself? I don't know what's going on here. But this is a different picture that we normally have when it's talking about connecting with God. A lot of times when we talk about connecting with God, we think of Jesus with a little lamb that he's gently holding. Or maybe just God's hands, because no one's seen the face of God, these huge hands that are holding this naked newborn or something. Or that Footprints in the Sand poem that talks about Jesus carrying us, right? That's how we want to connect with God. Most of us don't want a wrestling match with God. Jacob had everything, and most would call him blessed. He had everything. He had sheep, wives, tons and tons. everything that you could ask for or imagine. But it came at a high price. He got disconnected from the promises of God. He got disconnected from his family. And to reconnect, he kind of gives away everything that he has. He strips himself of all this that normally we would say is blessing. And he wrestles with this and says, just bless me. Bless me. But I think he's coming to the end of himself, realizing even if I send all this across the river, I cannot control my brother. Forgiveness is not something you can control. I cannot ask you to forgive me at gunpoint, right? Or through bribes. It doesn't work. Forgiveness is something from the heart. And I think this is what he was wrestling with. I think this wrestling was teaching Jacob something profound. Jacob still stubbornly thinks he can get a blessing, controlling a blessing by force. But I don't know if Jacob was blessed because he wouldn't let go. I think it happens earlier in the passage when his hip was taken out of place. I think Jacob got a blessing because he connected with God, even though it was violently with God. I think Jacob got a blessing because he connected with God and was broken. He became broken. God wrestles with us. God cuts through all the BS and tells us what's what. Have you ever had a thought from God, from the Holy Spirit, just pierce you, expose you for who you are? Have you ever had a thought just rip the rug out from underneath you, like Jacob, and you get up with a messed up hip? Have you wrestled with yourself and with God and ended up walking a little bit differently, a little more humbly? This is the only part of the sermon I'll talk about my vacation a little bit. And as I said, I'll try not to make you jealous, but we stayed with most of my family at a lake house in Illinois. We did fishing, we did swimming, some kayaking, some boating and stuff. It was pretty fun. And we did some swimming. Really encouraging. Nathan and Brendan jumped off the diving board for the first time, my 4 and 6 year old. That was great. That was awesome. And I had to jump off the diving board too, right? That was fun. Someone had made the diving board really loose. Any divers in here? What do you call that when you're loosening up a diving board or firming it up? There's probably some special word. Anyways, it was really loose one day. And I was jumping off of it. And it was loose and I was getting ready. I was coming. I was diving in. You know, nothing fancy, I don't do flips or anything like that, just a forward dive off of this. And then I stopped for a bit, and I saw someone make it really firm, so the exact opposite direction, when they make the board firmer as you're bouncing. And I didn't really think about it much, but I went back for my last dive. And I got up there, and I think I jumped thinking it was going to give the way it normally did, but it was much firmer, and something compressed in my back, and it just felt just... I dove in, and I was like, oh, and I'm just underwater, like, oh, man, oh, no. And I just swim to the side, and my brother-in-law's there, and I'm like, I think I'm going to have to just be here for a little bit. I did something. And I've done something to my back before, and I don't know. I've Googled it way too much these past few weeks. Herniated this, bulging this, whatever the pinched nerve or whatever, it was not good, and it just ruined the rest of my vacation. I'm much, much better now. But I think I was stretching wrong and made it worse probably. But there's something when that happens that this voice plays in your head, you idiot. What? You're a little bit overweight now. You know, why didn't you keep those pounds off? Why didn't you strengthen your core like the last time you hurt your back and kept doing those exercises? It's your fault. You're an idiot. You kind of wrestle with yourself in that moment of brokenness, in that moment when you can't control. I can't just my back to be magically fixed in this moment. Just when you think you have some control in your life, snap. It can be taken away and you can be humbled and you can just realize who you are, how limited you are, how really not in control you are of your life. Jacob seems to have literally wrestled with some divine figure, but the issue is deeper Jacob wrestles for what? To be blessed. We want to be blessed. He's going back to the land of promise and blessing. I want it so bad. That's why we control. That's why we want to control others, to ensure blessings for ourselves, maybe for our loved ones. But what is it to be blessed? Jacob had everything he needed, everything that he wanted, more wives and children than he can handle, more sheep than he knows what to do with. Jacob won the lottery of life while alienating his own kinsman, his very own brother. What Jacob needed was not all that he had. What Jacob needed was nothing. Nothing but brokenness. The struggle to be blessed, to wrestle true blessing, had led him down dark paths of manipulation and control. Isn't it interesting that he is given the name Israel, which we still continue with today to speak about God's people as Israel? He's given that name when he has nothing, right? He wants it. He wants God's blessing. He wants God's promise, and he's given that. He's given the name. He said, I want to be blessed. Okay, I'm going to change your name, right? That's kind of weird. You have it all. But to be blessed, you need a name change. One who wrestles with God. One who is broken. During small group on Friday, Charlene graced us with some Portuguese-style cookies that she brought back from Macau. And it was funny when Charlene opened it up, some of them were broken. Correct me if I, don't say this right, but there was a laugh from Charlene, and she said, well, they're broken, but they're easier to share, right? Something like that. Yeah. It was great. But as I was thinking about this sermon, I was like, that's true. When we're broken, we're easier to share. You can't get what's inside of a loaf of bread, and I think this is why Jesus breaks the bread. In Jesus' brokenness, he can share. In our brokenness, we can connect. If you're whole, if you think you're perfect, then you won't. That's too much of a risk to be broken, to be spilled out, to be put on display who I am and the inside to another person who might judge me, who might reject me. I want control. We don't read today what happens when Jacob meets the brother he stole from. But in Genesis 33:4, it said, but Esau ran to meet him and embraced him and fell on his neck and kissed him, and they wept. As I read that, I was like, that sounds line for line a parable of Jesus. Do you remember what you heard? When the prodigal son leaves and is exiled and spends the money foolishly and comes back, and the father sees him a long way off. Jesus speaks about that. The same way the father, with compassion, runs and embraces the prodigal, the exile, the one who is away and who returns home. When we are broken and when we embrace that brokenness, people cannot help but respond in compassion. It's not true, actually. Some people will take advantage of it. Some people may break you even more. That's the risk that we take. But if and when we take that risk, we allow the other the chance to express the grace of God to us. This is what Jacob, stripped of everything, confronting Esau, receives the grace of God through Esau and forgiveness. Our choice today is the choice of Jacob to control blessing and make everyone, including ourselves, miserable through manipulation and control, or to give control to God, to embrace brokenness, and to seek to restore relationships. One last story. This week, the boys, Lillian and I, mostly Lillian, started doing perler bead crafts. You know what a perler bead is? These little plastic beads you put on a little grid, and then you iron them and they fuse together. So you can do little pixel art and stuff. So we're making like Pokemon, we're doing Super Mario, and different things like that. Well, one of them was so Nathan made this really beautiful purple and white cross. This is cool. It looks like the cross of Jesus. Later on, Brendan comes by and he looks at that and he goes, "Oh, cool, a sword." And he grabs the cross upside down. He's like, "A sword." I'm like, "No, it's not a sword. It's not a sword. It's a cross." "No, it's a sword." No, it's a cross. "Can I make a sword?" No. We're Jesus people. We're people of the cross, not the sword. But as I thought about it, I'm like, this is really profound. Is not the cross the opposite of a sword? Did not, in going to the cross, Jesus say to Peter, "Put your sword down"? That's not the way we're going to go. The way of the sword is the way of control, of power, of myth. Give me that blessing. I'll take what is yours. But the cross is this wonderful brokenness, this wonderful symbol and expression of grace and forgiveness and healing. Who will you show your brokenness to? Who will show you grace? What's stopping you from doing so? May you be like Jacob, then called Israel, who was blessed by God and walked with a limp. Gracious God, forgive us for the ways we try to control blessing and control those in our life. Help us. Give us faith and courage to be broken.